What is up, watch fam? I am Christian, the curator of the Theo and Harris Vintage Watch Shop. You have to introduce yourself now.
Oh.
What is up, watch fam? I am Christian, the curator of the Theo and Harris Vintage Watch Shop.
And I'm the new guy.
Today we're going to be answering some audience questions about Hermes, skeleton watches, pet peeves, and next purchases.
And who the hell am I?
Let's do it.
Boom.
Boom, watch fan. All right, I guess before we get into who you are and what you're doing here, I guess we'll do a wristwatch check. What are you wearing?
Sure. I am wearing a Rolex 1601, the one that you actually gave me.
Hey.
Oh. What do you got?
I'm also wearing a Rolex 1601. It's like a membership badge.
Yeah. You have to buy it yourself, but you still get to wear it.
Christian doesn't give anyone anything.
Christian, no.
Christian makes you buy your own straws.
Yeah, it's like that episode of SpongeBob, I'm paying to work here.
I don't watch SpongeBob.
Me neither.
All right, so really, I was going to make you introduce yourself, but that's sure. It's the first question. So Michael, tell the Theo and Harris family what you're doing here.
Sure, so I'm doing videos. I'm going to be on the camera, behind the scenes, editing, working with Anna a lot, you know, general stuff.
Michael is our newest full-time employee here at Theo and Harris. You've been a fan of the company for, I don't know, 3 or 4 years. I mean,
I started working for the company 3 or 4 years ago, editing.
Yeah. Michael was editing videos. You were like one of the first people Anna. You were like the first assistant to Anna.
Yeah.
Years ago, and mm-hmm. You've been kind of you've kind of been asking to work here for a while.
Yeah, I've been begging to work here.
Yeah. Oh, Anna, wave, so they know you're still here. And you know, finally an opportunity, and now you're here. So we have a lot of big projects coming up, and it's great.
Yeah.
So I guess now more in depth, tell us your life story in 60 seconds.
Yeah, life story 60 seconds. Grew up on Cape Cod. Dad's a fisherman. Mom is not. Been making films my whole life. Basically short films, one feature. Big watch guy. Love watches. I funded my entire feature film by flipping watches. Mm-hmm. And that's been it. I'm really just about video. I fell off a motorcycle. That's why I had the scar. Do I have a life besides that? Probably not.
Yeah. Before we get into the question about the Hermes watch, I think that what's super cool is the Theo and Harris audience has basically seen me specifically, but Anna as well sometimes, talk about the future of the company and mm-hmm. the direction it's headed in, and the direction the company's headed in is kind of video consulting creation for major watch brands. Period.
Right.
End.
Right.
I love buying vintage watches. I love selling vintage watches. We sell a lot of vintage watches. We have a fantastic vintage watch shop. It's very successful. But, and I've said this before, and I'll say it again, selling a vintage Rolex, while it's a great experience for me, I actually enjoy meeting clients, I enjoy talking about them, I enjoy owning them and wearing them, mm-hmm. That doesn't make me feel like the way I want to feel. It doesn't make me feel successful, it doesn't make me feel smart. I don't think that selling a vintage Rolex feels to me like an accomplishment. It doesn't feel like growth. Right. So for a couple of years, we've had the plan, and in the past couple of, past year, we've actually been able to do it, where we actually create content. We storytell for major watch brands.
Exactly, yeah.
We're working right now with Grand Seiko, mm-hmm. working with London Jewelers.
Yep.
We're working with Omega pretty soon, which is unbelievable.
That's
we're working
huge.
Working with Nomos, we're working mm-hmm. with Laurent Ferrier, and working with Accutron. So this has all happened very, very quickly. So so we're pretty agile. And
oh, yeah,
we
definitely.
Just make it happen. All right, let's get into the first question, which is somewhat related to storytelling, but a little bit. Would you buy an Hermes watch?
Yeah, so short answer, definitely. And we talked about this actually before this video, but even now, I'm from Cape Cod and Hermes has the Cape Cod watch. Mm-hmm. So right away, yes, for sure.
Yeah, Hermes has a funny kind of history. They were a retailer of great watches at one point.
Yeah.
They double stamped for Rolex. There's mm-hmm. there's a gold, I think Rolex Paul Newman double stamped Hermes. They double stamped for Universal Geneve, mm-hmm. very similar to Tiffany, not at the scale Tiffany did, but very similar to Tiffany.
Right.
And then later, in the 80s and 90s, mm-hmm. they became, or maybe 90s, I have to fact check that. They became a manufacturer of kind of just branded watches. Their H watch was not a feat of horology,
right?
It's
like fashion but a little bit more luxurious type deal.
Right, exactly right. It's not like it's not fashion in the sense like MBMT,
but
it is luxury fashion watch.
When you get like a Gucci cologne, like a base level Gucci cologne,
right.
can get it in Macy's, but it's Gucci. It's that kind of
and
thing.
And you get to own a piece of the brand.
Exactly.
And that's what Hermes sold for a while.
Yep.
But in the last couple of years, I believe since 2016, mm-hmm. With their release of the Slim de Hermes, they've actually become a real watch manufacturer. Right. They've actually scaled up. I don't even know why. I don't even know if it makes sense for them financially. I have literally no clue.
Yeah.
But I think from a bragging point, you know, bragging right perspective, it's amazing. The in-house designs, in-house movements, and that's just one thing, but truly high quality. I want to show you a couple of these things. You know?
Yeah, for sure.
So you've got, this is their new Slim de Hermes. This is you know, obviously precious metal, asymmetrical, but it's balanced. The typeface is original. Even the case profile, while not necessarily hugely distinctive, is them. You know, that's not a stolen case. Yeah. It's an original design.
And what's interesting about that is we're both around watches all the time, but looking at that watch with the pusher on the top left, it's weird to say, what does that pusher do?
Right.
Especially if you work, you know, if you've never seen a chronograph, you're like, what do these three do?
Right.
But if you have seen a lot of watches, it's just like, that's weird. There's a button I don't know on a watch that I've seen a thousand times.
Yeah,
you know?
It's new. It's different.
Yeah, it's just totally new.
Even point your, it's the lugs. Look how original the lugs are. That's very cool.
The way it like rounds into the spring bar.
Yes. It's very unique. So, you know, we're all about originality. I want to see everything, you know, in-house and not just movements. I want to see dials truly new. You know, I want to see fonts. I want to see cases. Here's another incredible piece. This is the, this is their Arceau L'Or de la Lune. If I mispronounce that, I apologize to all my French fans. But this is incredible. This is a totally new take on a moon face.
This gives off, one, looks like Mickey Mouse. Two, it gives off like
the ears.
You see it?
You've ruined it for me. But
it gives off just a very prestigious watch brand. Not in the sense of like Rolex. It's like the next step of like, we take our designs and they're not sports models anymore. It's like an actual piece of art.
It's an actual piece of art, exactly. I love it in the adventurine. I love it in the meteorite. Mm-hmm. These are original materials. These are materials that you would expect from major, big watch brands.
Yeah.
But Hermès is incorporating them.
And we talked about this before, too, about working with watches a lot. You know, and obviously, if you're a big watch fan or you're watching watch videos all the time, you're always looking for something that breaks the norm. It's not just a circular steel watch. So as you get into watches, you know, you like square watches or triangles or the Crash or whatever. This, for me, is the exact same lane where you're like, the lugs are different on each side. Like, what is that? That's new. Yeah. That's something I want to see.
Exactly right. And I think that one thing worth noting is, you know, how does a brand jump from, you know, a luxury fashion watch to a truly respected manufacturer of watches?
Yeah.
And I think that the answer is not slowly. You kind of have to go, you kind of have to jump in.
You need to
go into the deep end, and that's what they've done. You know, yes, they eased in a little bit with the Slim, but since then, this was only 4 years ago, since then they've became very, very serious. They have their Ultra Slim Perpetual. I mean, they have these watches. It's very impressive. So Hermès is, in many ways, starting from scratch. Of course, they have a lot of brand history behind them, but their serious watch collection is new.
You know,
they're not Rolex, who gets to, you know, kind of take it a little bit easier. And
you know what Rolex is going to do.
Exactly. Speaking of which, we're giving away a Rolex, you know, soon. 100,000 subscribers. As soon as we hit it, we're giving away a Rolex. We're at like 92,000 subs right now. Get us to 100, and all you have to do to sign up is subscribe to our channel right here, right in that red button down below, and sign up in the form down below. We're going to literally put a Rolex in a box and ship it to one of you guys.
Gone.
That's it.
So
Hermès is not Rolex, you know. They need to work at storytelling to really build that brand foundation.
You can't expect what they're going to release yet. They're not at that point.
Right. The very short answer of the very long answer is yes, I absolutely would buy an Hermes watch. I look forward to seeing how they develop over the course of the next 4 years. If they've done this much in 4 years, I'm looking forward to the next four.
Yep.
But again, it's self-promotional, but I really do mean it, like everyone else. But it's particularly for them, because they are building a brand around this. Storytelling. They've got to tell their story, you know, more and better. I see spec reviews. I'm seeing it. You know, you can Google and find things.
This one right here.
But you've got to really touch people and convince them that an Hermes watch is worth owning, that it's not what it used to be. Mm-hmm. Not that that was bad, but that it's different and there's a reason that people need to pay attention. So I look forward to this.
Especially when there's the biggest question, you know, like you said in the beginning, why did you do that when that wasn't what you were doing with your watches?
Yeah.
Like, there needs to be some explanation to bridge the gap of like, we used to make these, now we make these incredible watches. Yep. Here's why. Here's our process.
Yeah, totally. So, yes. Yeah. Next question. Skeleton watches. Take this. What are your opinions? Are there any skeleton watches you like, dislike? What do you think?
Yeah, so the Zenith Defy in white ceramic specifically, love that watch. And more about, I love the ceramic case material being white, but the fact that it's a skeleton really balances out just the flatness of the white. I feel like it's really important to have something really striking in the middle. I think the skeleton does great there.
But you're big into like white ceramic watches, right?
Huge into white ceramic watches.
Yeah.
The Grail watch. Audemars Piguet Royal Oak White Ceramic.
How much is that?
I think it's 50,000.
No, probably more than that. Because it's only perpetual, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's got to be 100 plus. It has to be.
Okay, well, then I have to double my budget. Yeah.
So I love skeleton watches.
Yeah.
For what they stand for. Not just the material. I love, like I said before, originality, right? Mm-hmm. And the more, you know, the bigger bite you take, you know, the more you need to, you know, do to swallow, right?
Yeah, of course.
When you do something like a skeleton, you're really taking on a big burden. You're taking on a lot of extra work to mm-hmm. be true to yourself throughout the entire process. If you're just going to put a dial is easier to design and manufacture than a skeleton.
Right.
When you're talking about a skeleton, look at how much needs to be done.
Oh, yeah.
You need to make sure that even every single piece now, nothing's being hidden. Mm-hmm. Every single piece is within your design language. Here's some really good examples. You've got APs, Royal Oak Open Work.
Mm-hmm.
Everything about that watch is completely AP. Look how aggressive the finishing is. It's so industrial. It mm-hmm. is the exact dial you would expect on a Royal Oak.
And it looks like steampunk.
It looks steampunk.
Yeah.
Now put it next to the Vacheron. This mm-hmm. is lighter. It's cleaner. It's not as angry. It's not as aggressive or industrial. Vacheron's identity is different.
Exactly.
From APs. Then you can go. This is a fantastic one. FP Jorn's Vagabondage. You know, a watch. Look at that. It's fantastic.
Yeah.
That is completely Jorn.
Right. That's what I was gonna say. Yeah. 100% brand identity through the skeleton.
The equivalent is, you know, anyone can do something fairly, you know, simple, but mm-hmm. but when you're actually taking on an enormous task, how many brands can actually follow through?
Yeah.
It's the biggest, like, bragging point to me if you can do that. Okay, next question would be, what is your next watch purchase?
So probably the Zenith Defy, like we just said.
Yep.
But that'll take some time. So in the meantime, it's just, you know, looking to see what I really like. I really love Casio. Which is a huge thing.
You keep saying that.
I love Casio. They have a vintage all-steel watch. I would die for that watch. $150, I would die for it. It doesn't even matter. I'm worth $100, you know? Just to get that watch. That's probably it. I love Casio. Yeah. And obviously working for a watch company, like, I'll just steal watches from the safe when you're not there.
Yeah.
So it's not a big deal. But the Zenith Defy and the Casio. As weird of a pairing as that is.
Obviously, those are the exact opposite watches that I would pick. Mm-hmm. They're great.
The
whole idea, and I talked about this before with the OP conversation, is, you know, the whole idea about, you know, for me with watches is the more different they can be, the less generic they are, mm-hmm. the more specific they can be to your personality. And I think that's one of the best parts about watches, right? That's why I'm not a fan of a lot of very generic, very popular watches. You know,
me on the other hand, very generic.
No. Not at all. No.
Michael likes flat white with nothing on it.
No, it's a great watch.
Yeah,
I love the blue Defy.
Oh, yeah.
I would buy that watch in 2 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, I really don't know. You know, I'm always looking. What I'm lucky for is that my personal watch taste is very unpopular. It's very old man-ish. It looks like, it's very, you know, 50s to 70s, mm-hmm. you know, very small, precious metals, things like that. So the watches that I love happen to be fairly inexpensive. Like Piaget, I'm really passionate about that brand. A lot of the watches in my watch box really aren't all that much money in the grand scheme of watches. That being said, you know, I really do love, I love a Lange one, you know. And while they're fantastic watches, in the grand scheme of Lange, they're fairly simple. You know, you can get into the datagraphs and things like that. A lot of mm-hmm. my, you know, clients and friends own these watches and they're fantastic. But I can admire them from a distance, but a beautiful Lange one is fantastic.
Oh, yeah.
On different straps. I of course love the 1815 chronograph.
Mm-hmm.
That's a different league of money. You're talking now from 25 and up to 40.
Right.
But probably before then, I'll just pick up another fairly inexpensive Cartier or a little Calatrava or something.
So. I mean, that's what's nice though. You can open up your watch box and be like, oh, that's Christian's. And like most watch boxes, I feel like if I open them up and be like, okay, there's 4 subs and a Datejust.
Right.
Like whose is that? That's everybody's watch.
Right.
I think it's nice if you can get something to your personality.
Yeah.
Which you see like a $50,000 watch next to Casio.
Exactly right. You know? Yeah. I think that it's important for everyone. Yeah, everyone wants to go up in price, but it's like an exercise in personality and an exercise in really research.
How
can you go down market and find something you enjoy, you know?
And can you just get something that you're like, I don't care if this doesn't get a compliment from someone. Like, I don't care if the bezel's not, like, sparkling. Is it just a watch that I like? Because eventually it wears off. If you're like, well, I'm not getting compliments, like, I should sell this.
Right.
You know?
Yeah, I see that a lot.
Oh, yeah.
Next question. The last question is actually, do you have any pet peeves in watches?
I don't think in watches specifically, but my biggest pet peeve is when people buy a tool watch. Any function. You know what I mean? And they don't use that watch for that purpose. Not saying that if you buy a sub, you have to be a diver. But people that buy a sub and then safe it Or they won't go swimming with it. Or they won't get it wet.
Right. Yeah, I guess you know you're right. I don't own any tool watches, so I can't speak to that. I really wouldn't know.
Yeah.
I guess I understand what you mean. Yeah. Obviously, there's an exception when it comes to, you know, vintage particularly.
Oh, yeah, not vintage. Know, this is modern. You know, you go out and buy a sub and you won't go swimming with it.
But the question is, you know, think about Rolex now. I mean, you know, is the sub still a tool watch, or is it really now more of a luxury watch, status symbol, a great one, with some heritage?
You know?
I mean, what is the function of the sub now? Is it to dive? Is it to swim?
Does a diver even buy a sub, or do they just stick to their computer and go for it?
Yeah, I mean, if I bought a sub, and if I did, I mean, I like to hulk a lot.
Yeah.
Would I wear it in the pool? First of all, I actually don't even wear watches into the pool just because I get a bad tan line. So
yeah, you gotta have a good tan line, a full body uniform tan line.
But I see what you mean. I just happen to think you're wrong. my biggest, maybe my only pet peeve in watches. And it doesn't even bother me that much, but when I do see it, I would never do it.
Yeah.
I like to really match my watch to my clothing,
mm-hmm.
Not necessarily in color, but in mood. So you know, for example, if I'm wearing a particular suit, I wouldn't wear my Breitling Super Ocean Heritage.
Right.
You know,
right.
I would wear a watch, and that could be a $400 watch that I think better fits in that style. You know, again, to each their own. It's no problem at all. You know, as long as you're a watch geek, you're okay by me.
Right.
You know, but you know, sometimes I'll see and I'm talking about like even really famous fashion people, style people, whatever. They'll wear a tuxedo with a, you know, with a vintage tool watch, like a Navitimer that mm-hmm. I don't think really fits.
And it's just too big.
They're not wearing it in an ironic way. They didn't put enough thought into it.
That's the biggest thing. If you can see intention in a choice, fine.
Yes.
You can wear whatever you want, yes. Fashion wise, as long as you look at someone or people look at you and are like, okay, I know why they did that.
Yeah.
Or they chose to do that.
Yeah, you know? I agree. So yeah, that's it. I mean, I'd love to hear your guys' thoughts. Do you have any pet peeves in watches? If you do, please comment them down below. Obviously, subscribe to our channel at Dion Harris, as we mentioned.
Of course.
And that's it. Welcome, Michael, to the team full time.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
All right, adios.